day to all and welcome to Beyond the Gateway. My name is Naomi Rodriguez, and today here in the show, we have three wonderful ladies joining us for a session of Beyond the Gateway talking about cultural diversity. First one, we have Nina Stewart-Thomas. Nina, tell us, where are you from?
I'm from Reading, Pennsylvania originally, but my family is from Jamaica.
Very nice. Nina, tell us a little bit more about yourself.
This is my first semester here at WAU. I'm a public relations communications major, and I'm grateful to be here.
Thank you so much for being with us, Nina. Secondly, we have Maya Walker Burrows. Thank you so much for being here with us, Maya. Tell us where you're from and a little bit about yourself.
Hi, my name is Maya Walker Burrows. I'm from the island of Bermuda. I'm a sophomore and I'm a public relations communications major.
Excellent. Thank you so much for being with us today, Maya. And last but not least, we have Michelle Neda. Michelle, tell us about yourself and where you're from.
Hi, I've lived in Maryland for most of my life. Both of my parents are Mexican, but I was born here in the U.S.
Excellent.
This is my third year in college. Last year, I was at Villa Aurora University in Florence, Italy, and now I'm back at WAU.
Welcome back, Michelle.
Thank you.
So as we mentioned earlier, our topic today is about cultural diversity. And Maryland is considered to have one of the most diverse cities, which is Tacoma Park, amongst many others. And today we're going to talk about the diversity we have here at Washington Adventist University, also considered to be one of the most diverse universities in the state. And today, as we have these ladies with us from different parts of the world, we seek to explore the many nuances and the many differences as well as similarities we have between the cultures. Nina, you mentioned your mom is from Jamaica. Can you tell us a little bit about how you grew up? Did you grow up in Jamaica? Did you grow up here? Talk to us about that.
I actually grew up in Reading, Pennsylvania, which the culture is pretty different from Jamaican culture. It was kind of different growing up inside the home where the culture is Seventh-day Adventist and very Caribbean, where the rules are be proper at the dinner table, be careful how you approach someone, say hello, greet. But when you're in the city, you know, you're raised to be tough, don't speak to anybody and don't act a certain way. But I'm used to saying hello, hello, and people look at you like, what is she doing? So it was actually very different, but it was also a great experience to share my culture with others, which was actually fun.
All right. Thanks for sharing that. So though your parents are from Jamaica, you said you grew up in Pennsylvania. So
yes.
Both of them are from Jamaica?
My dad is actually from the Maryland area, actually Tacoma Park area. He came to WAU. So it was actually interesting because he has a southern nature with my Jamaican culture. So those clash at times, but it's a beautiful experience.
Very nice. Did you speak Patois at home?
Yes, at times I did.
Wonderful. You still keep it, right?
At times. When I'm around other Caribbean islands, it tends to come out.
All right. Thank you for sharing that. How about you, Maya?
Yeah, like Nina, I'm from an island where, you know, everybody is friendly. Everybody speaks to each other. I find younger generations are extremely respectful to older generations. So it is a little different being here, especially being from an island that is really small. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot different being in a bigger place. But it's not a huge adjustment. Mm-hmm. We're pretty modern, but I would say the size and how people relate and interact with each other and their manners is a lot different out here.
Yeah, so you came here when? When did you come here?
I started here in August 2018.
Oh, so you just came directly from Bermuda to study. Okay, so how did you hear about us? Like, how was the interaction and the placement here?
Well, I'm actually Seventh-day Adventist, mm-hmm. and I went to a Seventh-day Adventist school in Bermuda. So when looking for a university, I was looking for a place that was Seventh-day Adventist. And WAU really sparked my interest because it's on the East Coast. It's mm-hmm. very close. It's a quick hop to Bermuda. Okay. It's really close to the nation's capital, and I think that's something to take advantage of. I love how diverse it is here, and I think that's what really sparked my
interest. Does that remind you of back home, the diversity that we have here?
Yes. I would say the cultures here mm-hmm. are different.
Okay.
Yeah, it's diverse like home, but we have a different set of cultures that we call diverse at home. Mm. So it's interesting to, you know, meet and see new people of different cultures and understand and get to know them.
Okay. Yeah. How about you, Michelle?
So, like I mentioned earlier, both of my parents are from Mexico. They were both from Mexico City, mm-hmm. and then they immigrated here to the U.S. I was born in Texas, mm-hmm. And then my mother had an opportunity to work at the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, where she is right now, and that's when we moved up to this Maryland area. I became acquaintance to Washington Adventist University through their band and orchestra program. I started performing with them from my eighth grade year. And after a while, I started to love the campus, feel very a family feeling in this area with people from all different parts of the world and different experiences as well.
Okay. So Nina, let me ask you this. You mentioned you came from Pennsylvania, so a different state. Coming to Tacoma Park or Maryland as a whole, as you got here, was there such thing as, whoa, you know, it's still America, but it's a different state? You know, did you feel that change, that shift? Or was it like a smooth thing, like, oh, okay, you know, another very diverse?
I would like to say it was more of a culture shock, honestly.
Okay.
It was beautiful to see that there's so many different cultures here. It's not only on campus, but outside of the campus. Because where I'm from, it's just honestly either the Hispanic community or the Caucasian community. And the other communities are just in the middle. So coming here, it was beautiful to see that there's different islands, there's different nations, different cultures, and they all merge together beautifully. That's what honestly attracted me first to Seventh-day Adventist culture, but then there's so many cultures that you can grow and experience and travel and just really indulge and not only make friends with them but connect with them, because they actually understand the differences, you know, because they come from other areas, so everybody's just growing and trying to figure out life honestly together.
Wow, thank you. So Maya, you also came from, if she had a culture shock, I imagine for you, because you came literally all the way from a different country. So how was that process, you know, getting here? Did you have a culture shock as well, or the assimilation and naturalization was very quick?
I don't think my culture shock definitely was different, but it was different in the sense of, I mean, I've been to the United States, like I travel here often, so I'm used to the cultures of the United States and what people do and how they conduct themselves. I think my biggest shock was actually living here long term, because when I visit here, I'm just here for short periods, but living here and calling this life and reality, it was a bit different, because like I said, people in Bermuda are way more friendly. I'm from a very small island where if you don't know everybody, somebody knows of you. So it was different being in a bigger place where, like I said, the cultural customs are different. Everybody is really just worried about themselves. And I'm a shy person, so I'm in a new place and I kind of have to meet new people, meet new friends, and rediscover what my comfortable is here, because I was already comfortable at home. So I think that was my biggest adjustment.
Okay, and was there a process of assimilation, you would say?
I feel like I adapt fairly easily, but you know, just getting with the norms, because you know, we go back home and then we come here. So I would just say adjusting to the college life, that it isn't so consistent right now.
Okay. And last but not least, Michelle.
So in my time here, I've always been growing up in the American culture, but I go home to a Mexican culture that after a while has also merged with the American culture. So at the end, the term Mexican-American comes to life, with Spanglish being an active part, neither speaking fully Spanish or fully English and confusing the languages together. And now that I'm back from Italy, I also have Italian up in the mind. So I'm constantly speaking a mix of all of them. So it's always readjusting, translating, being a translator for both parents and for other people around in my daily life as well.
Okay. So Michelle has actually mentioned a few of the aspects of cultures that we seek to explore as well on the show. Right now we're gonna go for a quick break, and we're gonna be right back with Beyond the Gateway. Welcome back to Beyond the Gateway. As promised, now we will be talking about the elements of culture. Before we went on break, Nina, Michelle, and Maya mentioned some of the aspects like music, food, language, of their culture. that they have experienced in a different way because of the way they grew up. And now with Nina, tell us about the way you grew up. You had mentioned your parents are from Jamaica and you grew up speaking Patois, but tell us more. Did you eat the food at home? How was that?
Basically, when I grew up, it was a family, very close-knit. It was very respectful, very close-knit. It was traditions like every holiday or every Sunday, family dinner. You have to come together, eat traditional Jamaican food. They have different holidays like Boxing Day after Christmas. New Year's to Christmas, you gather together from the beginning of December till basically February. That's Christmas. Spring break is about 2 weeks. And it's not just only a religious thing, it's also a culture thing. You celebrate family-oriented respect for children, respect for elders. Passing down the language, passing down stories, tradition, respect for the culture, respect for, I believe they're very religious and respect for God at home too. So that's basically how I grew up and mixed with the Seventh-day Adventist culture, different to the point we're wearing skirts every day or to church or just respect. It's just a little bit different.
Okay, so did you get a chance of going back to Jamaica? Do you go often?
Yes, I actually go home every Christmas or every summer. So I actually just went back for Christmas last year. And it just was different because when you go back, you're used to the respectfulness, the humbleness, the interaction with people, speaking Patois every day, eating, getting to wake up and just have a relaxed, how you know say in the islands, a relaxed, cool vibe. And then when you come back to the United States, it's like, okay, you're not Jamaican anymore. You have to get back into the hustle and bustle. There's no more island food. You just can't grab the food. You just can't talk to people. You just can't go with the flow and just be yourself. Now you have to be, you know, speedy, do this, do that. So it's honestly different.
So let me ask you this now. You know, you mentioned growing up eating the food and everything, yes. Speaking the language especially. Mm-hmm. So do you think that if perhaps you had not been exposed to those things when you went back home to Jamaica, mm-hmm. would you be able to assimilate as quickly, or how do you think the interaction would happen?
I definitely think I was benefited from the way I was raised, because even sometimes I clash when I go home, trying to flow with them and keep up with the way they are, because sometimes they can be very aggressive in the way they talk and how they behave. So sometimes it's a little awkward for me, but then I have to remember, okay, this is how their culture is and we're just mixing cultures. Like sometimes I'll talk to my family and say, hey, remember, I was raised in the United States, so we do things a little bit different. So that's basically an example for that.
Okay, so sometimes it does feel, you know, despite having the same, you know, speaking the same language, eating the same food, sometimes it does feel a little bit like, okay, you know, I'm still not, you know, fully, because I was born in America, so you have both of those cultures,
yes.
So sometimes it's hard to balance. Yes. Michelle actually had mentioned earlier as well, she went to Villa Aurora in Italy. So you said when you came back, talk to us about that experience, you know, how was it when you came back and the language and everything?
Also, it's actually a lot like Nina just said, in Italy it's much more relaxed, you do things at your own pace. Families come together and they eat their meals together, or friends because we were in the cafeteria. But when you get back to the States, it's hustling, it's meal prepping, it's getting ready for the week. I actually don't live on campus. I live up in the Baltimore area. So coming down, it's a commute of at least an hour every day. So you have to plan ahead in time. Compared to in Italy, it was just, oh, would you like to do something today? Let's go do that. Go to an open market, walk around. Here it's, we got to plan out our grocery shopping and whatnot.
Okay, so, you know, sometimes it is thought that because you speak the same language or, you know, all these different elements of culture, because we have those in common, that it is easier to pick up. But earlier Michelle had also mentioned how she had a culture shock coming back from Italy, and she didn't forget her English. The English was still there, but the culture shock happened because, you know, assimilating those two cultures, you know, she was used to living one way, and now she comes back and, you know, things seem to be a little bit different, and people may not understand, why are you acting so Italian? You're American, or you're Mexican-American, as you mentioned before. Okay, but how long did that process take of you, you know, returning back to the normal, or is it even back?
So, and it's funny you say that. I don't think returning to the normal is even a possibility. The person I am today is who I am because of all the cultures that I have. I live in a Mexican family. I go to school in an American school, and my boyfriend is from Italy, which means that at the end of the day, my cultures now are three. And it's something that I love very much, being able to know so much about different cultures and being able to live in different cultures as well.
Yes, and that is very beautiful. Now getting a little bit more into, you know, the core of this discussion, we're going to ask Maya here some experiences you may have had. You mentioned earlier you're from Bermuda, and you know, you just got here in August. So I want you to talk to us about, you know, the experience you have had here in Tacoma Park, you know, assimilating with the culture. Was there any stereotypes or discrimination you have felt, or how has the transition been?
Yeah, I think when I come here and people ask me where I'm from and I say I'm from Bermuda, they automatically coin Bermuda with the term Bermuda Triangle, and it's a bit discouraging at times because the information that people have coined to the term Bermuda Triangle is very negative at times, and I feel very discouraged because I feel like people don't know Bermuda for the genuine, forward-moving, loving, family and God-orientated society that we are. So I just don't like when Bermuda has a negative light on that. Mm-hmm. I find oftentimes people mix up my race or nationality with something else, and I'm actually very proud to say, you know, no, I'm Bermudian, because I feel like a lot of times people don't actually know about the Bermuda culture or Bermudians or who we are. So I'm proud to shed light to people about who we are, what we look like, our mannerisms, you know, our genuine personalities. And that's just something I'm really proud to say.
That is beautiful. Yeah. And actually, I can very much relate to that because, as you ladies may know, I'm from Cape Verde Islands. And a lot like Bermuda, we're very small as well. Mm-hmm. So sometimes when people ask me, where are you from? I'm like, Cape Verde. And then we speak Portuguese. And they're like, oh, Brazil. I'm like, no, West Coast of Africa, 10 islands. So I definitely relate to that. But yes, it is beautiful to, you know, be the pioneer or the ambassador representing your country and, you know, presenting to people what it truly is about. Mm-hmm. How do you guys look like? What do you guys eat? The food, the music. And so all that are aspects of culture that are very important. And many times when we talk about culture, we associate it with, you know, diversity, you know, different nationalities. But today we also want to touch base on the cultures that we have, not only based on nationality, but gender, you know, different, not sometimes not even, you may be from the same country, the same city, but you have a different personal culture. So those are some of the things we want to talk about as well when we come back from our quick break. And as we're here, we just wanted to let you know and remind you to, you know, stay tuned. And these are students from Washington Advanced University. We're all students here, you know, communications major. And we have decided to do this because we do realize that we live in times, such difficult times, where sometimes culture is not appreciated or is not elevated or understood. So our goal here in the program is to help you be open-minded to understanding the different cultures that we have and the different nuances, so we learn to appreciate them. We're now going to go to a quick break, and we're going to be right back talking about the many nuances of our culture.
When it comes to your money, whatever you want to get smart about, you can find at smartaboutmoney.org. Smart About Money is a free online resource. We are a non-commercial, non-profit organization dedicated to helping people just like you get information about money. For everything from how to build an emergency fund to how to deal with job uncertainty, smartaboutmoney.org has the answers you've been looking for. Smartaboutmoney.org, the easy place to start when you want to get smart about your finances.
Welcome back to Beyond the Gateway. And that, for this last portion of our program, we want to touch base on some issues that we have noticed has brought some waves of discussion in our society, in our community. So over the quick break, we were touch basing and talking about, you know, how we feel as women in our community, you know, the different nuances and aspects of culture mentioned earlier. And actually, Maya was talking to us about, you know, race and how she feels that, you know, there's so many different aspects of it, like back home, how she was feeling, you know, she's not a minority. Everybody, you know, looks kind of the same, has you know, same values and et cetera. So Maya, talk to us about what you had just mentioned, you know, back home, mm-hmm. how we felt compared to here.
Yeah, I mean, I think that was another culture shock coming to America, because here I feel like a minority. I know I'm a minority, and I know society views me as a minority. But coming from a place that is not only a united society, but the predominant race is black, and I'm black. So at home, I don't feel like a minority. I don't feel like, well, if I do it this way, I'm gonna be a stereotype. You know, I don't feel that way. And although we have other cultures there, we're also a very united society, so I never feel like I'm not getting what I deserve, mm-hmm. or like they had a better chance. Like, that was a big thing for me, yeah. feeling like a minority here, yeah.
I don't know about you guys, but you know, coming here as well, it was interesting because, you know, you had to fill out this paper, what are you, white, black? I was like, what
the is census, the like?
I had exactly, I had never thought of that before. And I had a little bit of a hard time. I was like, okay, I'm African, but they, you know, it's like African black or African American. I think it's a whole category there. So if it was a little bit interesting. And sometimes we hear the term color blind. Have you guys heard it?
Yeah.
Some people think it's, you know, derogatory. It does not praise the different cultures because, you know, you're supposed to acknowledge me in the skin that I'm in and know how to interact with me and respect me. But you know, very much to be very honest, I believe I was color blind when I got here, because back home, like, you're white back home, you, yes, like, it's just we don't have this thing of, you know, black, white, Latino. We just, if you're fairer skin, you're like, oh, you're white. If you're darker skin, you're black. But it's not something that we have all these categories. So that was a challenge for me here. I don't know what you guys experienced maybe regarding that.
I can actually relate to Maya. Like, when you're back home in Jamaica, it's just black culture, black beautifulness. And it's like African queen, Nubian queen. But when you come here, you honestly feel like a minority. And it's weird because it's like, I'm not a minority. When I go home, black is the beautiful culture. And also being as a woman, it's a little bit different because back home, if you go for a job or simply going somewhere, you can wear your afro, you can be proud of your black skin. But I experienced in the work culture, you know, I was going for a job and I took my braids out because it seemed it wasn't correct for the position. And also being there, I remember a white Caucasian male, he got hired as the same position to me, but I started at $9 an hour and he started at $10. And he was advanced more in the position. He got trained on other positions and he was pushed forward before me, and we came in at the same position. And I honestly, you know, wondered, like, why? You know, I actually had been there longer than him. I was there 6 months before him, but he got trained before me, he got raised before me, and he got hired up to better positions, I believe, because of who he was.
And touching back on what Maya mentioned about minority, sometimes it's not even just the fact of, you know, oh, you know, I'm from Cape Verde, or I'm from Jamaica, or Bermuda, or, you know, I'm Mexican American. Sometimes it's even, you know, let's be honest, we are all women here.
Yes.
You know, sometimes it's the fact that, and that is one thing that we need to acknowledge in our society as well. And sometimes people may think, you know, it's a touchy topic, don't stare the waters. But, you know, this is some things we need to talk about, because we need to acknowledge that, you know, we as women, we have noticed a difference in our society. How, as you mentioned, you know, the fellow started later than you, 6 months later, but still he was paid $10. So these are things that we want to touch base on, because we know that our society is capable and able to make the changes, and that benefits everybody. You know, we not only talk about equality, but equity, you know, the same for everybody, based on what each and everyone needs. So, you know, you mentioned you had to take your braids off, and at that point it wasn't even more, you know, about me, a woman, you know, with hair and everything, you know, it was interfering on culture, gender, and all those things as well. Michelle, do you have, I don't know, any story as well?
Well, recently we were in our theory class together for communication theory, and we were studying the cultivation theory, and how a lot of the writers for TV producings right now are primarily white Caucasian men. And that is a problem, because we have so many races in the United States, that we have black people, we have Asian people, we have people from Africa, we have people that are black in the US. We all come from different parts of the world, and we all make up parts of the US, which means our writers for the rest of the US should be showing that diversity as well, so that we're all represented in that, not just primarily statistics saying that almost everyone is white Caucasian males.
Yeah.
A white privilege at the end of the day is something that in the US has come out more and more. Being that I am a Mexican of fair skin, my parents are immigrants from, their history is immigration from Spain to Mexico. And throughout the years, there was also the indigenous races such as the Aztecs and the Mayans, and they've all mixed in with each other. So at the end of the day, my face does have a Latina air to it. And people can see that I am Latina. And there are people that don't mind, they don't care, they love you and accept you who you are. And there are people that look at you and they think, I wonder if she came here legally when I was born here in the US. why would you need to call ICE on someone if you don't know if they are really American or not? Who cares?
Exactly. And you know, you bring that very important topic because, as you said, you were mixed and they actually came from Spain, you know, your ancestors. So that is something that is very key to remember when we talk about the history of America. You know, people that compose the country today, yes, we had, you know, Africans that were made slaves and brought here, but, you know, the Europeans that we now call Caucasian or white Americans, they are the ones that came, as Michelle mentioned, you know, from Europe, you know, from Spain, from different countries. But for some reason now, you know, it's like, okay, you guys are, you know, it's considered, you know, we have all this, you know, white privilege, etc. But, you know, you're mixed.
Yeah.
You're mixed. And I don't know, people of Bermuda, I know in Cape Verde we have a mixed population as well. But another topic of conversation, perhaps we can, you know, expand that for a different show some other time is, you know, how do you deal with people who are mixed, 50-50? I know you mentioned earlier Meghan Markle. We have Trevor Noah, Barack Obama. So all those people's 50-50, but at the end of the day, they would have to claim, you know, black. Imagine you were, for example, oh, I'm white. My mom is black or my dad is white. And at the end of the day, I'm like, oh, I'm white. But when people look at the color of your skin, they're like, no, you're not white. But at the end of the day, you would have to claim, you know, okay, I'm black. Or because you're mixed, it takes away. They look at it as something that takes away from you instead of adding to your culture, as you had mentioned earlier, you know, all the beauty of it. So what is the appeal, Nina, you would give to the city of Tacoma Park, to people listening online, people watching, you know, what, based on your experience, what is the appeal you would give them? What are you seeking for in this community?
I would say just be aware of different cultures and have a respect for who they are, because who we are is our culture and our nationality. And just be aware, be respectful, and don't discriminate. You know, we're all here. This is like a melting pot. There's so many different people here. And just be aware and be cautious when you're dealing with people and have understanding of people's different cultures.
Definitely.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And I would say, you know, recognize that everybody is different, and please do not use stereotypes, because everybody is different. You know, cultures, negative stereotypes do not define an individual. There are good and bad people in every culture and race, and I just think stereotypes are our biggest problem.
Yeah. We've all grown up in different homes. We all have different backgrounds. At the end of the day, we're all people. So just be mindful of where people are coming from, what type of homes they've grown up with, and what cultures are they accepting now.
Thank you. Well, we thank you so much for joining us today for a session of Beyond the Gateway. Our session is now over, but we invite you to join us once again for our next show, where we will journey once again in an experience where we will learn more about culture and different other topics that matter to the Tacoma Park City. Thank you so much for joining us, and see you next time.